brothers and sisters. I want to welcome you back to life. Back to the one that can make your next chapter your best chapter. Hallelujah.
How can it be that you love the most unlovable part of me? Of me. How could you see your life was the only gift I'll ever need to be free? It's amazing with you. I win even if I lose. Everything's working for my good for always.
Come on.
He saves the day. Woo. He will come through. We all know that's not what superheroes do.
Hallelujah.
No greater love makes my heart beat. All I wanna do is make you proud of me.
That's why. Let's go.
How can it be? Every one of my secrets that you keep.
You cover me.
You cover me.
I appreciate it.
A mystery.
It's amazing how.
Your patience with me, God will never leave.
You don't give up on me.
Don't ever leave.
Help me.
Help me to see like you.
Like you.
No matter what I go through.
Hey.
Everything's working for my good.
Tell you what he does.
He saves the day.
And he will.
He will come through.
Hallelujah.
He won't know that's not what's supposed to
be. I can testify that my life has been built on the foundation that was preached to me by my father, lived out by my parents. My life was built on that. My future, my marriage, my child, everything has been built on this foundation. This is what keeps us when things are happening that we don't fully understand. This is what anchors us, because we're not sure that we can trust God, that God is going to withhold something good from us if we obey him. But if you're willing and obedient, the Bible says you will eat the good of the land. Don't focus on the good of the land, focus on being willing and obedient.
Right.
I don't wanna love nobody, love nobody but you.
Yes. And the church saying, come on.
Loving you will be.
Jesus loving you
will be the death of me.
It sounds crazy, don't it? Hey.
That's how it's supposed to be.
Let me tell you what it means.
More of you, less of me.
That's why.
I don't wanna love nobody but you. Nobody but you.
Father,
I don't wanna love nobody but you.
I really mean it this time.
I don't wanna love nobody but you.
Jesus.
I don't wanna love nobody but you. I don't wanna love nobody but you.
Let me tell you what it does.
He saves the day.
Come on.
He will come through.
He will let you down, but
he won't.
You carrying anything that you're not designed to carry. And so I need you to cast all these cares, some of the cares that you don't fully understand, cast those cares upon me. Why? Because I love you and I care for you, and allow my grace, which is sufficient in your weakness, to sustain you. Don't be troubled. There's a place that God has for you with him in his presence. I'm going to make sure that you are right with me. I am the way. There is the presence of God, and God rewards you with his very self, with his presence. The reward is the anointing of God. The reward is the grace of God. Your destination is smack dab in the perfect will of God, in the presence of God. So I want you to see it until it drives you. I want you to see it until it drives on the sacrifices. You're going to give up anything that
welcome,
you need to give up.
Family, to come on, stand on your feet in the house. All those that are in the house of the Lord today, come on in the room this morning. Come on. want to just stand on your feet and begin to open up your mouths. Come on, come on, heat it up in here. It's cold outside, but it's going to be hot in here. Come on, come on, we got the fire burning on the inside of us. Just open up your mouths with me. He says, wherever there are two or three are gathered, I am in the midst of them. So right now, he's in the midst of us. Just lift up your voice for one moment and just begin to shout praises to God. Come on, it's enough of us in here today. It's enough of us in here today to bring heaven into this room. Come on, somebody. Father, we praise and bless your name. We lift you up and magnify you. We glorify you because of who you are. Come on, stay in that same vein. They said, we just been in prayer and fasting. Every night we came in, the fire was already burning. So open up your mouths and come on and praise him. Come on and just shout praises. And to all of you at home, get on your feet in your house and give God some praise. Come on, somebody shout great Jehovah in the house. Come on, family, let's go. Hey, put those hands on it like this morning. The Lord is great. His name is Jehovah. Come on and clap those hands. Hallelujah, it's real easy. Let's go. You are God and you're in control. You're seated high. You are Lord of all. The great I am, the sovereign ruler, Lion of Judah. You are God. Come on, sing it out.
And you're in control.
Seated high. Judah.
Lion of Judah.
You are
God.
Hey,
things will change
when we call on the name. Hands together just like that. It's great Jehovah. There's nobody like him. Great Jehovah. Hallelujah. Come on now, one real big voice in the house is real simple. Say, you are God.
You are God.
And you're in control.
You're in control.
Come on, seated high.
Seated high.
You are Lord of
you
all.
You are Lord of all.
The great I am.
Great I am.
Sovereign ruler.
Sovereign.
The Lion of Judah.
Lion of Judah.
Say you are.
You are God.
Hey.
Things will change.
When we call.
On thy name.
Great Jehovah. Things
will change.
When we call.
On thy name.
Great Jehovah. Things
will change.
When we call. Shout his praises in the house. Come on and say, great Jehovah, you're good and we won't stop praising. Come on, y'all, help me. Let's go, family. Let's go.
Great Jehovah, you're good and we won't stop praising.
Sing great Jehovah.
Great Jehovah, you're
sing
good.
Sing your good God and we won't stop praising. Y'all got it. Come on,
sing it out, great Jehovah.
shout of praise in the house. Come on and shout like you mean it. No, 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 no. Come on, raise it up in this building. Come on, we've been in prayer and fasting. All month it's time to praise his name. Come on and lift it up. He's great. Somebody say he's great. Come on, open up your mouth and call on the name of Jehovah. Come on, somebody, open up your mouths and declare that he's great, great Jehovah. My God is great. Come on, did he do anything for you over this fast? Somebody just break loose for a moment and go ahead and give God a praise on it. Put a praise on it this morning because he is great. If he's done anything for you, you ought to open up your mouth and bless his name. Hey, hey, hey. I don't know if you can tell I'm a little excited, but I came to praise him. Come on, if you came to praise him. Oh, Sherevosikaya. Hey, he's been too good for you to be too quiet. Come on, one more time, open up. He's been too good. My God. Hallelujah. God is good, family. He is good. He is so good. And this is a good place right here that God is more than able. I'm going to share something with you real quick. So some may know I was rushed to the hospital because I was having pains. And I went to the doctor, and they gave me a praise report that my blood pressure was 220. And Jessica said, we have to go now. I've never had these problems before. So I went to the doctor, and she wants to put me on medication. So the last night of the prayer, I came up to the altar, and I began to cry out to God because the word is clear. That God sent his word and healed us. Isaiah 53:5 tells us that Jesus bore the stripes on his back for my healing. And I am now seated in heavenly places with God, far above sickness, far above disease. I came to the altar and cried out to God. I said, God, this can't happen to me. I am a kingdom citizen. The medicine was on the counter when I got home. And I hadn't taken it. So I took my blood pressure. So it went from 220. And they said 170, 180. And I told Jess, this is not going to happen to me. I reject it. I refuse it. It is a lie of the enemy. It is impossible for me to be sick. I'm a man of God, full of the power of God. So she said, okay, baby, we're praying and we're believing. It's in the prayer when Pastor Paul called for everybody to come up. I went up to those stairs on the left side in Aurora, and I began to cry out to God. And I didn't pray from a place of begging and pleading, because prayer is not begging and pleading. Prayer is you getting a heart of God, then praying the declarations from heaven to bring about in this earth what you need in your life and for others. So I begin to tell the devil to take his hands off of me. And I command healing to flow out of me, the Zoe life of God, that resurrection power. And soon as we got home, they said I had to check it and take my medication and take the medication. I said, I'm not going to take it. Soon as she took it, my blood pressure was 116 over 78. And every day since then, it's been there. And the doctor said, I don't have to take medication. Now, she thinks it's a fluke, but I know. Come on, somebody. Not will God only do more, but God will do more than. God is the God of more than. So if you're on medication, this is not a judgment against me to you. But there is something better. He's more than able. Can he heal you? I'm telling you this morning, he is more than able. Can he deliver you this morning? Come on, can he bring you out? Somebody say he's more than able. Come on, tell your neighbor he is more. Come on, family, let's let him know this morning. He lift those hands all over the building and just begin to worship. Come on, release your worship in this moment, because I know he's more. Thank you. Thank you, Lord.
When did I seem to forget all of the great things you did? How did I throw a favor for thee?
Y'all got it.
And how did I start to believe that you weren't sufficient for me? And why do I talk myself of sin?
Hallelujah. Just lift it up, family.
You are more than name.
Just stretch those hands and sing to him this morning.
You are more than me. Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? It's easy for you, Lord.
Come on, one voice all over the building.
Now I see all that I have.
And I got my confidence.
Tonight.
table. Raise it up real big in the house. Just sing it out, family. Say it. Release your worship all over the building. Come on and release that worship right there. Come on, come on, release it. Come on and release it to the whole. Your whole. Come on and release. Thank you, Lord.
Jesus. Jesus, your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all. Above all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions. Your name stands above them all. Sing it out. Jesus, your name
is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all.
Above all thrones.
All thrones and dominions. All powers and positions. Your name
stands above them all. And the angels. life, Lord. You will always be righteous in my life, Lord. You will always be magnified in my life, Lord. Hallelujah. There is no one like you. You are holy, holy. There is no one like you. You are this place, Lord. Hallelujah. Lord, we bless you. We bless you, God. We bless you. I don't know if you guys all were able to attend the prayer this week and last week, but the prayers of the righteous availeth much. You can even feel the difference in worship. So as Pastor told us in the conference, let's continue on in prayer. Let's be a church of prayer that doesn't just come together every once in a while, but as the head of the church has made this a prayer church, then we have to trickle down and make our homes prayer homes. So we don't just do it at church, but we take it home. We take the worship home. We worship in front of our children because our children are getting used to being around other stuff. We have to get them used to being in worship, to where they don't look at worship like it's weird, to where they don't look at the Holy Spirit speaking through someone as it being weird. Let them know the power of God, not only in church, but in the homes. Amen. Amen. It's been a blessed time of worship with all of you. Go ahead and greet your neighbor and turn your attention to the screen.
Praise the Lord. Can you hear me yet? All right. Those new speakers are working just right. Praise the name of the Lord. Well, I want to see that movie there. We are so excited about what God is doing. And yeah, that's right. We have one person that's praising God for what he's doing. Thank you. Thank you, Sister Patty. I got my amen section. Great to be a part of the kingdom for such a time as this. Want to welcome those of you who are watching online, all snuggly and cozy. Well, I want you to know it's hot up in here too. And we are excited because we're just seeing the faithfulness of God throughout this week. As some of you know, we dedicate the first 10 days for prayer and fasting. And during the week, we meet. We come here at 7. We were coming here at 7 o'clock on those days. And this year was a little different because we didn't have a formal agenda in prayer. But we just kind of opened things up and let the prayer flow as the Holy Spirit was leading us. Because the Word of God says we don't know what to pray for sometimes as we ought to. And the Holy Spirit is the helper, and he helps us to pray the will of God. And that's what we did. We kind of launched out into the deep. And it was, for your pastor, it was nerve-wracking. Because it's easy, much easier when we have a solid plan, and I know how this prayer is going to go. I know who's going to do what and where it's going to end, and we're going to crescendo here and praise the Lord. We're going to dance and celebrate God's goodness. But this time, kind of like Abraham, stepped out of his comfort zone, not knowing where he was going, and we were stepping out in seeking God's face wherever he was going to take us. That's where we were going to go, being led by the Spirit. And God is faithful. We saw signs, wonders. You heard Brother Parrish testify. I didn't know that one, that, you know, God healed his blood pressure. That's a small thing with our God. As we were seeking his face, he spoke, the Holy Spirit moved, lives were touched, people got filled with the Holy Spirit without hands being laid on them. You know, in the Pentecost, when the day of Pentecost was come, they were together in one place, and during that time, they were actually praying for 10 days, because Jesus ascended on the 40th day after the Passover, and the Pentecost Sunday is that 50th day, and so they went 10 days just praying until the Holy Spirit came in Acts chapter 2 like a rushing mighty wind, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak with other tongues. Well, we know that in that instance, you know, people actually heard languages. They heard the wonderful works of God, although they were mostly Galileans. They were Galileans. But people had come to Jerusalem from all different parts of the world to celebrate Pentecost. And they are people who spoke different languages and heard the wonderful works of God. But God also, that was the initial sign of people receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit. But there are, in the scriptures, you see different types of speaking in tongues. There's a kind that requires interpretation in 1 Corinthians 14. And there's a kind in which no one understands. And so the Apostle Paul says, when you're gathered together, don't just start speaking in your prayer language, because if the sinner comes to your service, the person who doesn't understand what's going on, they're going to think you guys are a bunch of lunatics. So don't do that. Make sure things in the church are done decently and in order. But when we come together and it's just believers and everyone understands what's going on, I mean, we went in and people were praying and the Holy Spirit fell in the place. And our Sunday school children, I was sharing my own testimony, because I don't remember when I spoke in my prayer language for the first time. It was too long ago. As you guys know, I was pretty much born in the church. So I never knew anything else. And I know that my father, he was a Nazarene minister. And in his Bible school, whenever they got to 1 Corinthians 14, they just skipped over that, because that died off with the apostles. God doesn't move in the gifts of the Spirit like that anymore. And they just skipped over it. And so he shares about how when he was pastoring the Baptist church in Wheaton, that there were some ladies that went in to this meeting and they got filled with the Holy Spirit and they were speaking in their prayer language. And because he had been exposed and he had experienced that before, because there was at Wheaton College, there was a revival going on, and people back in the 60s, late 60s, people started receiving this baptism of the Holy Spirit. It was happening all over. It was happening in the church world in America. In Catholic churches, it was happening in Baptist churches all over. It was something was being released, something from the book of Acts was being released. And so he had heard about it, but then he saw someone that they prayed for die. And so although he experienced it, he saw someone die during that time whom they prayed for and they prophesied this person going to live. You saw that person die. And so he said, Lord, forgive me. I was in excess. And then he just put it away. But when these ladies came back, he never asked God about it. He asked God for it. God gave it to him. And then he saw someone die who they said, you know, was going to, you know, they prophesied and prayed, you're going to live. And so he just threw it all out. But after that, the ladies came back and he was going to deliver them from the excess that they were in. And God rebaptized him. And from that moment on, he's never let it go until he went to be with the Lord, you know. And so that's something that in this seeker-friendly type environment for church life, I take responsibility. I kind of hid that and said, okay, we want to make sure that we don't scare people. But then over the years, I see the impact on our children not seeing the power of God. So you can have controlled, organized services, but not see the power of God. And if our children don't see the power of God for themselves, and they don't have an experience for themselves with the Holy Spirit, then they become more defenseless against the lies of the culture. There's no, you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. So we just allow the power of the Holy Spirit to flow. And we stepped away from our program and God did just that. So we saw, as I said, I don't remember getting filled, but I just opened up to the things of God. And I just remember praying in my prayer language and leading my best friend. I was in second grade at the time when I, second or third grade, I think it was second grade when I led my best friend in the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And, you know, he wasn't going to our church at the time. We were in the neighborhood, but he had his own church. But when we were best friends, so when he became a teenager and could decide where he wants to go, you know, he could drive, and he was in church. And then one time we were praying, and I listened and I heard him praying in the Holy Spirit. That's a big deal, because you know, teenagers sometimes, if they don't have the fire, they pray very quietly. If you don't have fire, you just, when there's people praying, you don't have the fire, you're kind of afraid to be bold in it. But I heard him pray. I said, you pray in tongues? What did you get me? He said, what are you talking about, man? I've always prayed in tongues. What are you talking about? And I realized that our children, because we had children 6, 7, 8, when they heard my testimony being filled, they in during the prayer conference came forward and they started babbling in the spirit. And it reminded me that they're not too young. They're not too young, and they can receive the Holy Spirit. They can pray and ask God to fill them, and he does. And if they continue in that, they're going to, the Bible says, when you pray in the Spirit, rather than just being limited to praying whatever you think and praying your mind, because our mind is limited. And so we don't know what to pray for. I mean, when I'm praying in English, if you're praying 2-3 hours, you're going to run out of words. Or your mind is going to be distracted or whatever. And you could just pray. The Bible says, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. So, church, I've gotten off on this tangent to say we're not going back. And that's where the message of recalibrate came, because I realized that in my leadership, I've drifted from some things that my Father, he put in the foundation. The Apostle Paul talks about in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, he talks about apostolic foundation. There are some things that are in the foundation. When this church was born, when this church was started, we started believing and embracing the gifts of the Spirit, the power of God for today. And in order to be more acceptable and more palatable, I took some things that were in the foundation. I said, okay, put that in the back room and hide it. And God, I believe, challenged me to say, give way for the Holy Spirit to move. Now, we're going to try our best not to weird you out. But we are open. We remain yielded, submitted, surrendered for God to move supernaturally outside of our plan. And we're not going to apologize. And as we have stepped out, we're seeing things that we haven't seen before. God is good. And one of the things that we walked out, because it was just beautiful, just flowing. The worship and everything was just flowing. People, when they feel like going to the altar, they came to the altar and just lay whatever burdens they had before the Lord in the altar. And it was the church being the church, seeking God. And we walked out committing, saying, this has to continue. This has to be something that is a part of our DNA, a part of our life as a church, because we praise God for wonderful churches around us that are preaching the word of God and ministering the needs of God's people and sharing the gospel. And, you know, different churches might have different areas of emphasis. It's one Lord, one faith, one baptism. So if they believe that Christ died according to the scriptures, that he rose again on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he's coming back again, if they believe in those things that are non-negotiable, there's those things, there's no debate, we could find unity in that. And a matter of fact, next Sunday, many churches are going to be coming together on Sunday evening at 7 o'clock right here. We're hosting this meeting. We're partnering with our Messianic brethren, New Jerusalem, and we're holding a unity service here. And I encourage you to come out in full force Sunday. And you know, it's going to be a time of prayer. And during that time, I don't want you to break out in the Holy Ghost, okay? We're here for unity, all right? We'll do that when we can do that when we're by ourselves. But when we're coming together in unity, don't act out. Unless, you know, that's the plan. Unless they start, okay, here's the caveat. If the Holy Spirit breaks out and we lose control and you see the Methodists and the Baptists and the Lutherans start to break out, then you're free, all right? If that, just don't start it. Okay. All right. We're good? Yeah. We're just flowing here. Amen. Some wonderful things happening this year. We are on TLN. That's the very first station that we were on television. And so this year we're expanding our reach, and we are on... we're partnering with TLN. Some of you know that used to be called TV38. If you're old school, real old school, and it's now become TLN Media. And this blessing that my father walked in, and this blessing that he released upon his family and upon our family, there's an inheritance attached to it. There's a seed that was sown. And the children, physical and spiritual, we're standing on their shoulders and we're reaping the harvest. And my sister and brother, Pastor James and Sharon, they pastor Inside Church in Tinley Park. That entire television station was handed to them. And so now they own it. And so we are working together. And so we have joined them. And it's interesting. Any of you guys remember when Pastor used to come on Sunday morning at 11 o'clock on Sunday morning? Some of you guys remember that. Guess what time we're on? 11 o'clock Sunday morning. We are on right now. And so we come on right before, I'm at 11, Pastor James is at 11:30. And so that hour is back with the anointed word. This one's the anointed word with Paul Arthur's. But God is good. And so keep praying for us. And that's why, I mean, there are some things God saw in advance, and some of us are catching up. That's why God put in our heart last year to do this legacy project. That's why, because there are some things for where God has taken us that have to be in order in this house, things that have to come together, because God is expanding our territory, expanding our influence, expanding our reach to communicate his love to people who desperately need it. And things that we don't think about, things that we think are carnal, like new carpeting and paint and, you know, we just need Jesus. We don't need any of that. But the Bible says they continued in the temple and from house to house. There was the corporate gathering as well as the connect groups. And so there are some things that we have to get together in the house. And among the things that is included, we upgraded some of the audio, but there's some things that have to upgrade in the house. And so we encourage you, we're not finished with the legacy. We started in March, and there are some things that God is doing. And in that is the new, the upgraded video equipment. So continue to allow God, the Holy Spirit, to speak to you in giving. Amen. Let's just do that right now. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, and bless you for the opportunity we have to give. You've given us everything. All that we are and all that we have is from you. And you give us all things that pertain to life and godliness. And so, Lord God, we right now, in the beginning, this second Sunday of the new year, we declare that you are our priority. You are first. You are honored. And we thank you, Lord, for trusting us with seed to sow. We thank you for trusting us with resources that we can give to advance your rule and reign on the earth. And we are empowered by your Holy Spirit, our Lord, to get wealth according to your word, that we can establish your covenant in the earth. And we give you the glory for that. We obey you and we respond in total obedience as you prompt us, as you move on our hearts concerning giving and receiving in Jesus' name. Just go ahead and obey God, and we know that every need is met. All right. Let's jump into this word. I am so full, and I'm excited to share with you today. Thank you, Lord. Heavenly Father, we just bless you and praise you once again for the privilege of gathering around your word. Open our eyes to see. Open our hearts to understand. As your sheep, we hear your voice. Thank you, Lord, that you anoint my lips to speak the very oracle of God, the life-giving, transforming word to your people. and we will never be the same as we receive the word of God. We are changed in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So as I said earlier, the word that was germinating in my heart and spirit is recalibrate. And I was seeing some areas that need to come back in line, come into divine order in my life. You know, it's possible to be in the church and yet be out of order. It's possible to be one who's testified that Jesus Christ is Lord. But there can be areas that have not been surrendered to Christ. It's possible to say, I've decided to follow Jesus, but yet your life is off course. The trajectory of your life is off. And you are finding yourself in places where God is not glorified. And as we're walking, sometimes we're just a little off, but off is off. And the Holy Spirit does not allow you to be comfortable going on a path to destruction. In Acts chapter 27, Paul was on a boat, and he says to those that are steering and driving the boat, he says, I perceive that the course that you are on is going to end in destruction. Some of us, we've ignored the warning, and if we continue on that course, there is disaster ahead. Some of us, if we continue on that course, it's going to cost your marriage or your children or your job. You're on a course to destruction, and you need to consider your ways. The Word of God says, a passage of scripture that we're all very familiar with, telling us what we ought to be about, telling us about our priorities in life. In Matthew 6, Sermon on the Mount, most famous sermon that's ever preached, Jesus is speaking, and he's speaking about how we live and our priorities and the things that we think about and worry about. And he says in verse 25, he says, don't worry. Don't worry about what you're going to eat. Don't worry about your life, what you're going to eat, what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? He goes on to say the birds, they don't worry. The birds know that God is going to take care of them. The birds have more faith than a lot of people. Now, I remember hearing this from Pastor Jackson. God takes care of the birds. He feeds them. But just notice, and this is for all those people who think, you know, it's just going to drop out of the sky like manna. The birds get up early. And you see them searching, digging for their food. The Bible says, if a man shall not work, he's not going to eat. So God provides, but he blesses the work of your hands. So stop just sitting there looking for checks in the mail when there's no work associated with that check coming. But Jesus says, don't worry. And he goes on to say in verse 31, again, therefore, do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For after all these things the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. In other words, don't live for what the world is after. Have a different priority than people who don't know God. There should be a difference. I know we're all driving down the Eisenhower to get to work, but there should be a difference in your pursuit versus their pursuit. You're after the glory of God. Everyone is going to work, but you're going to work with a different purpose. Everyone is working, but your work is different because you work heartily as unto the Lord and not unto man. You see, they're trying to get promoted. They're trying to be seen. They're trying to get ahead. Your goal is to glorify God. You're on kingdom assignment even when you go to work, even at the job. That's why when you're in the marketplace, you don't get ahead by putting other people down. You don't get ahead by stealing, or you don't get ahead by shortchanging the company. I know of believers who are in this church who, although they were tithing and giving, they were shortchanging the company that they worked for, and they got caught. You know, pretending that they're working, and yet they're not. That's not how you as a believer go to work. Gentiles, the people who don't know God, that's what it's referring to, are worried about their life. What's going to happen to me? How am I going to make it? Your life is hid in God. He's your Father. It depends, you know. If you're a child and your parents are broke, then you start to hustle and you start to worry. But when your parents are extremely prosperous and you grow up with a silver spoon in your mouth, you have to fight the spirit of entitlement. You don't worry about, you know, what are we going to eat? What am I going to have to eat? You don't worry about those things because the refrigerator is stacked with food. Jesus says, your heavenly Father knows. He knows what you need. Even our prayer. When Jesus says, when you pray, don't start off with your needs. Don't start off with, Lord, you see what's going on. I need, you know, rent's due. My kids need shoes. Don't start off like that. When you pray, start to glorify God. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. You are holy, Lord. There's no God like you in the heaven. There's no God like you in the earth. I just bless you, Lord, as your child. The Bible says in Acts chapter 13, as they ministered unto the Lord and fasted, the Holy Spirit spoke. God began to speak. They were in prayer, but their prayer was not asking for stuff. Their prayer was just ministering unto the Lord, just blessing him. Coming to your heavenly Father as his beloved child, saying, Lord, I love you. Lord, I thank you. Yeah, there could be all kinds of things going on, all kinds of needs that you have. But it's good to go before the Lord, even with all your needs, knowing that your Father knows, understands, cares, and you don't have to worry. You just have to believe and trust him. Your Father knows these things. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. So many of us are pursuing the things, after the things, and we're after stuff that is in the kingdom. So Jesus says, don't pursue the stuff. Pursue the kingdom. The kingdom is God's rule, reign, authority. God's rule and God's reign and God's authority in your heart. That Jesus is enthroned on the seat of your heart. That in your personal life, Jesus is king. He rules over your life. You belong to him. He's your master. He's your owner. In your family or in your marriage, Jesus rules in your marriage. So your marriage is a reflection of Christ and the church. Your marriage is to glorify God. Your marriage is to honor God in any area of the relationship where Christ is not honored. As a husband, I have to submit and I have to honor God in my marriage by dying. My wife honors God in our marriage by respecting me as her head, as I'm submitted to Christ. As we honor, we're declaring that God rules, that it's not just an ordinary marriage like everybody else gets married, but this is a kingdom marriage. Our marriage is to glorify God. Our family, our children are to glorify God. This is what we are to pursue. This is, if you have New Year's resolution, this is your resolution. This is where we have to look and take inventory and see if there's any wicked way. Search me, O God. Know my heart. Try me. Examine yourself to see whether or not you are in the faith. Bring these areas before God. Lay them at the altar and take a good hard look and see if there's anything in your life, anything in your thought life, anything in the way you speak, anything in the way that you think, anything in the way that you interact. Is there anything about you that's not glorifying God? Lord, search me. Am I loving everybody? Is there anybody I'm holding anything against? This is seeking first the kingdom of God. This is taking inventory to see if God is ruling, or is there any area of my life in which I'm running the show? Is there any area of my life? Because sometimes we're just doing things. We're just making decisions. Decisions that are not submitted to God. I mean, you just decided, well, this is what I want to do in life. Did you pray about it? Did you ask God about that? And we could spend our entire life just doing something that God never told us to do. And that's why you're frustrated. That's why you hate Mondays. Because God never told you. He didn't create you for that, but you just decided one day this is what you want to do. And God never called you to that. Now, I'm not telling you right now to quit your job, but if you pray about it, and God says, yeah, I never called you to the factory. I called you to own the factory. Then you can start to prepare and move toward that place of calling. Think about it is, I think I love about God is God's love, God's word finds us where we are. Disciples were fishermen. That's where it found them. So it doesn't matter where the word of God finds you. You know, if you spent 30 years and you never prayed about it and you were just doing that, and now the Holy Spirit is bringing to your remembrance that thing that he spoke to you when you were a teenager and you saw that it's coming back to you. It's okay. God knew that you would be at this point, and this is the point where you would ask him those questions. Examine every area of your life. Is it submitted? Are you surrendered? Or are there some places where you are fighting against God and being hard-headed, stubborn, stiff-necked? Seek first God's rule, God's reign, God's authority. That's where that idea of recalibrating kind of comes in right there, because as I commit to seek first that which glorifies God, he tells us to pursue two things here. Says to seek two things: seek the kingdom, seek righteousness. Paul says it as well in 1 Timothy chapter 6, I believe. He says to Timothy to pursue righteousness. Seek the kingdom. Seek God's rule. Seek God's reign. God is in authority, and you move away, step away from the driver's seat. This is not your show. This is his show. And you're a passenger, and he's running it. And you're submitted to the Holy Spirit for the Holy Spirit to lead you in life. In every area. He rules over every area. Even your thoughts. So you don't even get to think thoughts of hatred and ill will. I mean, sometimes when people get on my nerves, I might not say anything, but I... You know, my spirit man is got a lot of muscles. In the spirit, I'm just knocking them out. In my mind, I'm just taking them out. Sometimes my children don't even know. They don't know what just happened. But those areas have to be surrendered. My thoughts, man. God is really up in your business. He says, I want you to think thoughts that are edifying. That person who gets on your nerves at your job that you see every day, always got something to say stupid. And they come and say something stupid to you. It just, you know, that makes you walk away. God want you to think thoughts that are virtuous, that are praiseworthy, that glorify toward the person who you would consider to be your enemy. That you don't think evil. You don't wish evil. You don't wish God would just zap them. No, you say, forgive them, Lord. I don't want to see them punished. I don't want to see them hurt. That's the rule and reign. That's the kingdom of God. Realize that many people are in church, but few people are in the kingdom. Many people walk around in church, but there's a difference between walking in the church and living in the kingdom. I realize there's a difference. The kingdom is when God is in charge. The kingdom is when your life is Holy Ghost led. I'm going to get into that. Seek first the rule and reign of God. Many of us are in church, but we're not in the kingdom. Now, Jesus says, he says it in Mark chapter 1, verse 15, repent and believe the gospel. Jesus began to preach the kingdom, saying, repent and believe. Repent, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Or the kingdom of heaven has arrived. But There are so many of us that, you know, unless a man is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. So you say, Pastor Paul, what are you talking about? We're in the church. If I'm a part of the church, and the church are those who've been called out of darkness, called out of sin, those people who have renounced the devil and all his works, they've been baptized in the name of the Lord, those are the people who have been separated, called out, declared holy, and they're part of the church. Yes. And those people who are part of the church, when they die, they are absent from the body and present with the Lord. They will hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant." And they will enjoy the manifested kingdom of God for all eternity. So those people who are in the church, truly in the church, they are destined to enjoy the future kingdom that's manifest. Jesus says, when we celebrate his supper, one of the promises that we have is when Jesus says to his disciples, "I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until I drink it again with you in my Father's kingdom." So Jesus is going to come back again, and he's going to prepare the table, and he's going to dine with us in the manifested kingdom of God. Those who are a part of the church, those who are saved, those who are believers in Christ are destined to be a part of that banquet when Jesus comes again. But that does not necessarily mean that they are going to experience God's kingdom here on earth. Why am I saying this? Because, well, let's look at Romans chapter 14, verse 17. Are we together? Romans chapter 14. "For the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit." The kingdom of God is not eating and drinking. That's what, don't worry about what you're going to eat, what you're going to drink, what you're going to wear. Are you guys connecting those two scriptures? It's not about that. It's not. But the kingdom, God's rule, God's reign, God's authority, enthroned in the heart of the believer. Because there are some people who have confessed Jesus and received forgiveness of sin, but Jesus, their heart, the Bible says, "Demas has forsaken me because he loves the world." Solomon loved a lot of strange women. The Apostle John in Revelation chapter 2 tells the church in Ephesus that you have forsaken, turned away from your first love. They're still Christians, they're still believers, but they are no longer doing the first works. Revelation 2, verses 4 and 5 tells us. So, I'm in the church, but Jesus is not in charge. And it doesn't, I know what the Bible says, but hey, we're all sinners. That's the kind of attitude that we see prevalent in the culture today. It says the kingdom of God is not eating or drinking, but it's righteousness, peace. Peace, we know that's the shalom. Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you, be gracious unto you, and give you peace. Jesus says, "My peace I give to you. My peace I leave with you. 1 Thessalonians 5:23. May the God of peace sanctify you whole, spirit, soul, and body. Peace, it speaks of wholeness, completeness, nothing lacking. It speaks to every void in our lives, everything that's missing. It also speaks and implies God's blessing and provision. Where is this peace? Where can it be found? It's in the kingdom. It's in the kingdom. The kingdom of God is not meat or drink, but it's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. In the Holy Spirit. I shared this a little bit on Thursday during the time of prayer. If you have your Bibles and you're looking at that verse in Romans 14, verse 17, make sure you highlight, do something to magnify that little preposition in. Because there is a whole world in that verse. There's a whole nother life in that verse. The kingdom of God has a location. The kingdom of God has a location. There's a place where God's rule and God's authority and God's power is manifest. It has a location in the Holy Ghost, in the Holy Spirit. That's why I've had to recalibrate. Because the church was born when the Holy Spirit came. So what do you think the enemy's strategy is against the church? Let's take out the Holy Spirit. And if you take out the Holy Spirit, the same way if the Spirit is removed from the body is dead. When God, Spirit means breath. That's why when God breathed into man, man became alive. In Ezekiel chapter 37, you see the valley of dry bones. These are dead bones. And Ezekiel is commanded by God to prophesy to the wind. When they were all together in Acts chapter 2, the day of Pentecost was fully come. They were in one place, they were all praying for 10 days, and the Holy Spirit came as a rushing and mighty wind. That wind represents the breath of God, the breath of God that brings life. So when the wind came, they were filled, and for the first time now, the church is alive. 3,000 souls are gathered. So if the enemy wants to stop the church from being relevant, impactful, powerful, he will cause believers to chase the Holy Spirit out. Now, the Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter 3 that in the last day we'll see dangerous times. Men are going to be lovers of themselves. They're going to be ungrateful, ungodly, disobedient to parents. But in all this, it says they're going to have the form of godliness. Let me turn to 2 Timothy, because it's important that you see this. 2 Timothy. And we're just sharing and teaching, and then 2 Timothy chapter 3, All right. Wait a second. I don't think I'm in the first. That's what's throwing me off. I'm in first. All right. Let me get it together here. Yes. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Let me just read this. Let's start verse 1. But know this, that the last days perilous times will come, for men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful. Wow. Unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. Now, if it wasn't for verse 5, I would think that this is just talking about people out there in the world. I would think that he's talking about people that are, you know, out there in the strip clubs or living in some very dark places. But this verse 5 doesn't seem to match. It says they have the form of godliness, but denying its power. What does Acts chapter 1 verse 8 say? You shall receive. What does it say? You shall receive. But this type of form, they got the shape, they got the form, they got the building, they got the art, they got the religious symbols, they got all of this stuff that looks spectacular, but there's no power. We can go through the practice of religion. And when you read your Bible, you see Jesus didn't come to establish a religion. He came to establish a kingdom. Read Luke chapter 19. He came to establish a kingdom. But what man does is we make a religion. But he didn't come to establish a religion, another religion. He came to establish a kingdom. They have the form, no Holy Spirit. So when the enemy wants to make the church ineffective, let's just get a bunch of programs. Let's have some nice buildings. Let's get smoke and lights. Let's really, you know, give people a good presentation. And their children will come through that. When they become teenagers, they'll be more and more disinterested. And when they have the power, they're out of here. And they'll serve the devil. No power. No transformation. No deliverance. No freedom. No fire. No zeal for the things of God. The kingdom is manifest and revealed in the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Ghost. And so, in order to be in the Holy Ghost, Jesus says you have to be baptized. You have to be submerged. You have to be plunged in the Holy Ghost. Our problem is that we have not been immersed. We might have been immersed in church, but you haven't been immersed in the Holy Ghost. When we are immersed and baptized in the Holy Ghost, then we start to manifest the power of the Holy Ghost in this earth. So Jesus says, seek first the kingdom and his righteousness. And the kingdom is found in the Holy Ghost. Righteousness is found in the Holy Ghost. Peace that is dealing with your lack and the things that you're longing for and the desires that God has put, it's found in the Holy Ghost. Joy where you're going to bed full of the joy of the Lord instead of crying yourself to sleep every night and not being able to rest because you're tormented by nightmares and demons and thoughts of hurting yourself and just wanting to, no, it's joy in the Holy Ghost. And so I encourage you to make your way, find your way into the presence of God, into the Holy Ghost. Because that's where the power that brings all these other things is manifest. Don't go after the things. The things will follow you. The blessings will overtake you. Find your way in the Holy Ghost. And so we have to go there. And next week, by God's grace, we will continue moving there. Stand to your feet. Thank you, Jesus. Praise his glorious name. God is calling you beyond your comfort zone. Last week we talked about the deep. The Holy Spirit, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 10, searches the deep things of God. You're continuing to go deeper. You're continuing to go deeper. Your prayer life, your relationship with God must go deeper. Get out of the shallows. Get out of the place of comfort. Get out of the place where you have to be in control of everything, where you have to run everything. God's ways are higher than your ways. His thoughts are higher than your thoughts. As long as you stay limited to your own opinions and ideas, you're stuck. But if you open yourself and allow God by his Holy Spirit to baptize you, he will show you great and mighty things that you don't know about, but God wants to reveal in your life. Praise his name. You have the Holy Spirit. If you're saved, you have that well of life. Jesus says, if you believe on me, you're going to have that well. He says that in John chapter 4. But he says in John chapter 7, there's also a river, which is very different than the well. And that river is something that cannot be controlled or limited. And so if you need to give your heart to the Lord, if you need to know that your sins are forgiven, that it's well with your soul, God loves you, he died for you, he brought you to this moment because he cares about you so much, and he wants you to know that you don't have to walk through life with that guilt and that shame. But you can be aware and you can know what it is to be in right standing with God. You can know what it is to be in right standing. You don't have to be feeling guilty all the time. You can have boldness. If you want the assurance, if you want to know that you know that you know that your sins are forgiven. I've sinned. And one microscopic sin would cause the eternal, holy, and righteous God to say to you, if you stood before his presence, if you died and were to stand before his presence, he would have to say, for one small little sin, depart from me, you workers of iniquity, I never knew you. Why? Because God's standard is absolute holiness, absolute perfection. We couldn't attain it. We couldn't achieve it on our own. But Jesus, the spotless Lamb of God, paid the penalty. He was the only one that was able to stand between you and the wrath of God for your sin. And he stood on the cross and he took on the wrath. He could handle it. And as you put your trust in him, his righteousness, he took your sin and he has given you his righteousness, his holiness. And you can receive that by believing. And your sin is forgiven. And you're a new creature in Christ. If you want to know that you know that you know that it is well with your soul, allow us to pray with you. Just lift that hand high. No one's going to embarrass you, but we're going to pray with you. And Christ is going to come in your life right now. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah to Jesus. If you're sincere in this, just repeat after me. Say, Heavenly Father, I thank you for sending your Son to die on the cross for my sin. I admit that I've sinned and fallen short of your glory. But I'm asking you now, forgive me, wash me, cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Make me new. From this day forward, I'm a child of God. I receive you as my Lord, my Master, my Savior. I am saved. I am delivered. I am healed. I am restored. I am whole. In Jesus' name, amen. If you pray that, you are as saved as you will ever be. Jump into a Bible-believing, Bible-teaching church. If you raise your hand here in the house, I need you to follow through on that decision you made. And everyone who met Jesus confessed him publicly. If you're ashamed of me before people, Jesus says, I'll be ashamed of you before the angels of heaven. So I need you to make, before you leave, one final step. I need you to make your way to the altar. You can begin coming right now. Make your way to the altar. If you confess that and you meant that and you know God has forgiven you, I need you to come and we're going to give you some literature and we're going to hold you accountable and we're going to help you to continue to grow. We sometimes make this the end. It's just the beginning. Your journey has just gotten started, and you'll see where God will take you if you follow through with obedience. Amen. Talked about the Holy Spirit a lot. Talked about your prayer language. It's available to every believer. The Bible says in Acts 2, they were all. So it destroys that argument that says, well, it's not for everybody. You know, it must not be for me. I don't deny it, but no, it's not for me. It's available. But like any free gift that's available, you have to receive it by faith. If you would like to receive the baptism, it's a experience subsequent to salvation. In Acts chapter 8, Peter and John, they make an additional trip to people who were already saved and baptized in water. But they weren't satisfied because they wanted to have the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I can just start to rattle off a bunch of scriptures, but I'm not going to do that. You know if your heart is hungry. And if you want that power to be a witness, the kind of witness that you ought to be, the Holy Spirit is not for you to act funny, but it's to empower you to be the kind of witness. Maybe you're a witness at school or at your job. Your life should glorify God. It should glorify God to the maximum. If you want that, I've asked God to forgive me. And I said, we're bringing the Holy Ghost. We're giving room for the Holy Ghost for people to receive the Holy Spirit and to receive their prayer language. As we are, I believe in pastoring a Spirit-filled church. And as we're all filled with the Holy Spirit, we're going to move with a different level of power and authority. So if you want the baptism of the Holy Spirit, there's a grace. And God's not going to give you some bogus, funny, crazy, stupid thing. No, the Bible says if you ask for the Holy Spirit, he's going to give them to you. Amen. So we want to make that available to you. As we leave, we're going to remain here. And don't leave without your spiritual need met. If you came after the tithes and offerings, just obey God. And we know that every need is met connected with your obedience to God and my obedience. You agree with that? Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for what you're doing in our midst as we leave this place and not your presence. May no evil befall us, no plague, accident, and mishap of any kind come near us. May all of us reach our destination safely and come back again in the fullness of the blessing. I speak, Lord, to those, our Lord, who are viewing online, Lord God. I thank you, Lord, that that same anointing is released, Lord, that your people are beginning to live in the Spirit, walk in the Spirit, think in the Spirit, Lord, to manifest your glory in the earth, to live in the kingdom, and to prove and manifest your rule, reign, and authority in the areas that you've called them. And we thank you once again, Lord God, for what you're doing in our lives and in this ministry. In Jesus' name, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you so that Jesus is seen all over you and give you his peace. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. You are dismissed. Wheaton Christian Center. Amen. If you want to be filled with the Holy Spirit, if you gave your heart to the Lord and you want to get your free literature,